بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. أما بعد إن شاء الله to continue with the series of the durus about the etiquettes in the life of the Muslim. We talked last time about the etiquettes of al-utas, sneezing and yawning, and how would the Muslim like do if he sneezes or yawns, and how does the Muslim respond to that? Inshallah, to continue, the next adab or the next etiquette that we'll be talking about is adab wa iyadat al-marid, the etiquettes of visiting the sick. And as we will see, inshallah, visiting the sick is something that is very virtuous. And when we see that our deen had put an emphasis and so much virtue for this action, then you see how it was so much careful about bringing the love and strengthening the relationship between the members of the Muslim community. And we will see that this even will even extend to visiting the sick that are even non-Muslim. Because the nature of the human being is that, yani, he loves for people to feel that people are taking care of him. And he loves to have attention. And definitely when he is in a position of weakness, in the state of disease, then he will look for this even more. And it will leave more impression in him if he sees that someone cares about him, especially when he is in that state of weakness. When we talk about عيادت المريض, عيادة المريض meaning visiting the sick. If you look at the Arabic language and why the expression of عيادت was used, is because this is something that can happen repeatedly. So when we say, for example, عيد, we call عيد الفطر, for example, or عيد الأضحى, or whatever عيد it is, and in our deen we have those two عيدs. We have the weekly عيد, for example, of الجمعه, that happens every week. And then عيد الفطر is عيد that happens every year. Likewise is عيد الأضحى. So anything that happens repeatedly, شيء يتكرر, is called عيد, من المعاودة أو من العود. And that's why عيادة المريض is being called that way, because the sick is often someone who is visited, can be visited by multiple people and be visited by a single person repeatedly. And that's why it was called عيادة المريض. But anyways, this is something that has so much benefits for the one who is being visited, the sick, and for the one who visits him. For the one who visits the sick, when he goes and he visits his sick brother, then this is something that is important for him, because he sees the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he is given the health. And this is something that oftentimes we do not pay attention to unless we see the negative counterpart of it, right? So when the one is always healthy, he always eats whatever he wants, he always drinks whatever he wants to drink, he sleeps whenever he wants to sleep, and he wakes up whenever he wants to sleep, to wake up. Whenever he needs to do something, then he can go and take care of it himself. He doesn't need someone else to do it for him. And this is his norm. Maybe he will not recognize this as a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when it comes that he sees that someone is deprived from such a ni'mah, then he realizes that this is one of the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا, that if you count the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you won't be able to count it. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Ibrahim, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَظَلُومٌ كَفَّرٌ. Indeed, the nature of the human being is that he's ظَلُوم, he's transgressor. Kafar, he does not recognize the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in Surah An-Nahl, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeated the same thing, saying, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا, if you count the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you won't be able to count it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. But indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the is the most forgiver and he's the most merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this is one of the things that the one realizes when he sees someone who's deprived from the ni'mah of the health, right? And there is the dua of seeing someone who is mubtala, someone who's afflicted by a disease that will come with us, inshallah. For the one who's visited the sick, there is also a great benefit for it. Because, again, the one when he is sick and he is himself experiencing the fact that he is being deprived from a ni'mah that he used to enjoy for a long time, and he did not even recognize it was a ni'mah, now he is in a position of weakness. And the human nature is that when the one is in weakness, is in state of weakness, then when he is, yani, when he recognizes that there's attention that someone is giving him, then it has more influence on him. And then he's more vulnerable. And that's why it is a good chance of reminding someone. And maybe he will humble himself when it comes to the disease state, because now he is in a position of weakness again. And we'll see the story of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even with the Jewish kid that he went to visit him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yani guided him to the deen of Islam yani by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his last moments, right? And this is again like a great opportunity for reminding someone, because even maybe the disease state that the one is in, maybe this is his terminal illness, maybe it's not, but regardless, this is an instance where again it has so much effect on him, and the one can utilize it in a very good way possible. And then for both of them together, this is definitely something that yani brings the love between the hearts of the Muslim. If he recovers, he remembers that, and it has so much influence when it comes to bringing love, like we said. Visiting the sick, before we proceed and reading from the book, is one of the rights of a Muslim on a Muslim. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, حَقُّ الْمُسْلِمِ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمِ خَمْسِ, that the right of a Muslim on a Muslim is five, he mentioned among them عِيَادَةُ الْمَرِيضِ, visiting the sick. And the ulama talked about whether this is something that is يعني, for the istihbab or as something that is fard. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah went with the opinion that it's fardu kifaya, that meaning that it is something that is a fard on a portion of the community to do it. And if they do it, then no one is sinning, but rather as long as like a portion of the Muslim community does it, then yani, the right is yani, doesn't stay on everyone as long as someone does it. But anyways, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had put so much virtue in it. And when you see the virtue through the hadith that we will read inshallah, you will see that how much emphasis was put on it. Other than the fact that it is a right of a Muslim, it is something that the one seeks the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by doing. And like we mentioned at the beginning, it has many benefits for both parties. So the author here starts by saying, فَضْلُ عِيَادَةِ الْمَرِيضِ, the virtue of visiting the sick. عن ثوبان رضي الله عنه عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ثوبان, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من عاد مريضا لم يزل في خرفة الجنة حتى يرجع, رواه مسلم. He said صلى الله عليه وسلم, whoever visits a sick, he will still be in خرفة الجنة until he comes back. Narrated by Muslim. The Sahaba asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا خُرْفَةُ الْجَنَّةِ, what is خُرْفَةُ الْجَنَّةِ? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, جَنَاهَا. It's الْجَنَاهَا, like it's crops or it's fruits, something in that meaning, right? So as if he is in that position until he comes back. وَعَنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, Abu Huraira, may Allah please with him, said, the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, مَنْ عَادَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ زَارَ أَخًا لَهُ فِي اللَّهِ نَادَاهُ مُنَادٍ أَمْ طِبْتَ وَطَابَ مَمْشَاكَ وَتَبَوَّأْتَ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ مَنْزِلًا, أخرجه الترمذي وابن ماجه, والحديث حسن. In the sound hadith narrated by الترمذي وابن ماجه and Ibn Majah, the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whoever visits a sick person, or he visits a brother for him for the sake of Allah, then a caller will call him and he will say, طبت, that be goodness for you. and goodness is in your path, and may you get a position in the Jannah. May you get a position in the Jannah. And this is something that is virtuous for, like visiting, this is the virtue of visiting a sick or visiting someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And both of them are very significant, right? The subject here is about visiting the sick, but visiting the visitation for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is one of the very virtuous acts. And yani, the virtue of this hadith specifically applies for both visiting the sick and visiting a brother for the sake of Allah. Whether he is someone who lives with you in the same city, or whether he's someone who is, you know, living in another town, and you just make the effort of making the trip and taking the journey in your busy life schedule to go and visit him for nothing but for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this has so much virtue to it. When in the hadith, when a man went to visit, like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, went to visit a brother for him in another city. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَيَعْنِي أَرْسَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَى مَدْرَجَتِهِ مَلَكًا. The Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sent on his way, on his journey, as he started his trip, sent on his way an angel. This angel was in the form of a man. And he asked him, where are you going? He said, I'm going to such and such town. He said, why are you going? And he said, I'm going to visit such and such. So the angel told him, أَلَكَ نِعْمَةٌ تَغُبُّهَا عَلَيْهِ. That is this, yani, is there a benefit that you are going to go and get back from him? He said, no, إِلَّا أَنِّي أَحْبَبْتُهُ فِي اللَّهِ. He said, no, except that I loved him for the sake of Allah. Meaning that this was the only reason that he went to see him. So the angel told him, so no, that I am the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you to tell you that he loved you for the sake of you loving your brother for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of the hadith. But this is something that's very virtuous. And this is often something that we neglect, especially when it comes to the Western type of living that we live. Because it's all about my own time, my own benefit. What can I do? What works out for me, right? Does it fit in my schedule or does it not fit in my schedule? If it doesn't fit in my schedule, then okay, I love you, but I have my priorities, right? But what about going out of your way so that you do something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and express this love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as you go out from your usual norms, right? So that you do something only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not about only about the materialistic things of things. And this is like one of the things that we lose. It extends even to losing this value when it comes to relatives. We're not even talking about the mother or the father. We're not talking about the brother or the sister. We're not talking about the cousin. We're talking about someone who you love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if he's not someone who's related to you. So what about those who have more right on you when it comes to your mother and father and brothers and sisters and your kinship? This definitely has even more and more right for you. But nowadays, we don't even have time for that. So this is just something for us to remember. And this is one of the things that is stressed out in our deen. And this has something that's so much virtuous. وعن علي رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول. Ali, may Allah please with him, he said, I heard the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, من أتى أخاه المسلم عائدا مشى في خرافة الجنة حتى يجلس فإذا جلس غمرته الرحمة فإن كان غدوة صلى عليه 70,000 ملك حتى يمسي وإن كان مساء صلى عليه 70,000 ملك حتى يصبح. رواه أخرجه أبو داود وابن ماجه والحديث صحيح. The authentic hadith narrated by Abu Dawood and Ibn Majah, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever comes to his brother, to his Muslim brother to visit him, he will be walking in the khirafat al-jannah, in the crops of the jannah, until he sits down. فَإِذَا جَلَسَ غَمَرَتْهُ الرَّحْمَةِ. And when he sits down, then he will be surrounded by mercy. If it was in the beginning of the day, a 70,000 angel would make salah on him, prayer for him, until the evening comes. And if it was in the evening, then a 70,000 angel will be making salah on him until the morning comes. And it's authentic hadith. And so it shows so much virtue for such an act, for visitation for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, when the one is sick, he is more in need for this visitation. Some of the early generation, they used to, if they want to visit a sick, they would go either early in the morning or early in the evening, because they wanted to get the benefit of the hadith, so that they would get the virtue of the angels making prayers on them for a longer time period, right? If it was, like the hadith says, if it was غدوةً at the beginning of the day, this is what the غدوة is, right? A 70,000 angel would make a prayer on the person until the evening comes. That's why they were so much careful about the virtues and the ajr, the rewards that they would get. They would go early in the morning. See, this is like one of the ways they used to apply the hadith in their life. And if it was in the evening, they would go early in the evening so that they would get the benefit of the angels praying on them for a longer time period until the morning comes. But anyways, and this is so much virtue for the one to think even about it. Might be coming with us, but there are so many other virtues for it. In other ahadith, many ahadith that mention the virtue of visiting the sick, and how this would be one of the reasons for entering the Jannah. In the known hadith narrated by Imam Muslim, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once said to his Sahaba, he was with him and he said, من أصبح اليوم منكم صائما أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, who among you woke up fasting today? And Abu Bakr said, I did. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, who among you visited a sick? Abu Bakr said, I did. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَن مِنْكُمْ شَهِدَ جَنَازَةً أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, who among you had witnessed a janaza? Abu Bakr said, I did. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَن أَطْعَمَ الْيَوْمَ مِنْكُمْ مِسْكِينًا أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, who among you had fed someone who is needy today? And Abu Bakr said, I did. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that those four will not be together in one day in a person except that he will be in the Jannah. Right? Known hadith narrated by Imam Muslim, rahimahullah. Right? So among the four things that would be a reason for the one to enter the Jannah is visiting the sick. In addition to the fact that he would fast and would witness a janazah, or feed someone who is in needy. And all those are very virtuous actions. But again, to stress out the virtue of that. In the other hadith, also narrated by Imam Muslim, in the Qudsi hadith, I will read it from here because I can't remember exactly the nas of it. Abu Huraira, may Allah please with him, he said, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ يَقُولُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says on the Day of Judgment, يَبْنَ آدَمْ مَرِضْتُ فَلَمْ تَعُدْنِي. He will say, O son of Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, O son of Adam, I was sick and you did not visit me. So, the son of Adam will say, قال يا رب كيف أعودك وأنت رب العالمين. The son of Adam will say, Oh my Lord, how can I visit you and you are the Lord of the universe? قال أما علمت أن عبدي فلانا مريض فلم تعده, أما علمت أنك لو عدته لوجدتني عنده. He said, didn't you know that such and such of my slaves was sick and you did not visit him? Did you not know that if you had visited him, that you would have found me with him or at him? Then he says, يَبْنَ آدَمْ إِسْتَطْعَمْتُكَ فَلَمْ تُطْعِمْنِي. قَالْ يَا رَبْ وَكَيْفَ أُطْعِمُكَ وَأَنْتَ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. قَالْ أَمَا عَلِمْتَ أَنَّكَ أَنَّهُ اسْتَطْعَمَكَ عَبْدِي فُلَانٌ فَلَمْ تُطْعِمْهُ, أَمَا عَلِمْتَ أَنَّكَ لَوْ أَطْعَمْتَهُ لَوَجَدْتَ ذَلِكَ عِنْدِي. يا ابن آدم استسقيتك فلم تسقني قال يا رب كيف أسقيك وأنت رب العالمين قال استسقاك عبدي فلان فلم تسقه أما إنك لو سقيته وجدت ذلك عندي. Then the hadith goes and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, O son of Adam, I have asked you for food and you did not feed me. And the slave would say, O my Lord, and how come I can feed you and you are the Lord of the universe? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, Didn't you know that such and such of your slaves had asked you for food and you did not feed him? Didn't you know that if you had fed him that you would have found that with me? O son of Adam, I asked you for drink and you did not give me drink. And then the slave would say, O my Lord, and how can I give you a drink and you are the Lord of the universe? Then he would say, such and such of my slaves had asked you for drink and you did not give him drink. Didn't you know that if you had given him drink, then you would found that with me? Again, this hadith was narrated by Imam Muslim. And it shows the virtue of like these actions, visiting the sick and feeding and giving drink for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the comments that the ulama made about this is that see the expression of the hadith, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it came to visiting the sick, right, he said, لَوَجَدْتَنِي عِنْدَهُ, that he would have found me at him, at his place, right? If the one visits someone who is sick. While when it came to feeding and giving the drink, he said, لَوَجَدْتَ ذَلِكَ عِنْدِي, then you would have found the rewards of that with me. And see the difference between the like two expressions, finding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like at the one who is sick, and finding the reward of the action of feeding and giving the drink for the one who would give that for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, both of them are like very virtuous, so much rewardable, right? But to find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what else does the one want? I mean, whoever finds Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is the ultimate thing that the one wants. And one way of finding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to visit the sick. So again, all these are so much virtues for visiting the sick. And really, if the one, again, lives with the mindset of seeking the hereafter, and this is what he is looking after, then he would be looking for these things. He would be asking about this, not even waiting for someone to tell him that such and such is a sick person, let's go and visit him. He would be inquiring about that, right? And trying to, like for example, wake up one day and say, I'm gonna apply the hadith of Abu Bakr, what he did. He would fast, and in the same day, he would look for a janazah, and he would witness it. He would ask about someone who is sick, and will try to go and visit him, and he will go and find someone who is in need and give him some food. And the Prophet ﷺ said that those four things would not be together in one person in one day, except that he will be among the people of the Jannah, right? And this is, again, one of the things that we miss when it comes to the heart being hardened by a very materialistic pattern of living, right? But rather, if the one is around people who would remind him with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, the general atmosphere being an atmosphere where everyone is looking for the other and having the virtue of like witnessing the janazah, something that we miss a lot, right? We every now and then hear about the janazah and then we will calculate, well, can I make it? It's 20 minute drive. I won't be able to make it. I have other things to do, right? And all these things, right? Can I fast today or would I miss my cup of coffee, for example? You know, the lunch break is what I'm waiting for in the middle of the day. And then, you know, missing the opportunity of finding someone who is poor, who is in need. And all these virtues are things that, yani, the one is really, like if he ponders about it, so much time in our life that we are missing. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make yani, his our mercy on us. When it comes to حكم عيادة المريض, the ruling of عيادة المريض, the hadith of Al-Bara bin Azib, may Allah please with him, he said, أمرنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بسبع. Al-Bara bin Azib, may Allah please with him, He said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had ordered us with 7 things, and he forbade us from 7 things. He said, أَمَرَنَا بِاتِّبَاعِ الْجَنَائِزِ. He had ordered us with following the funerals. وَعِيَادَةِ الْمَرِيضِ, and visiting the sick. وَإِجَابَةِ الدَّاعِ, and responding to the invitation. وَنَصْرِ الْمَظْلُومِ, and giving victory for the one who is oppressed. وَإِبْرَارِ الْقَسَمِ, and if someone makes a qasam, an oath, to help him to make it out, for it to happen. وَرَدِّ السَّلَامِ, and responding to the salutation. وتشميت العاطس, and making tashmeet of the one who sneezes. And then of course say Alhamdulillah, like we learned in the last session. ونهانا, and he forbade us from آنية الفضة وخاتم الذهب والحرير والديباج والقسي والاستبرق. And he forbade us from the utensils of silver, and from the gold ring, of course for men, and al-harir, wal-dibaj, wal-qissi, wal-istabraq, the silk for the men of this ummah when it comes to different grades of this silk and thickness and all these things. But among the things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had ordered them, according to the hadith of al-Bara' bin Azib, and this is a hadith that is agreed upon, narrated by al-Bukhari and Muslim, is following the funerals and iyadat al-mariyad. عِيَادَةِ الْمَرِيضِ, like we said, يعني he brings the hadith to say that this was the order of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And that's why we said that Shaykh الإسلام تيمية went with the opinion that it's فَرْضُ كِفَايَةِ, that a portion of the community has to do that, otherwise they will be sinning. وَإِجَابَةِ الدَّاعِ, and responding to the invitation. Responding to the invitation, this is just like a side subject, but since it's mentioned here, is one of the things that is virtuous. For your brother to come and visit you, and for your brother to come and invite you for an invitation, it's actually something that is virtuous to respond to his invitation. And this is one of his rights. And this is something that will bring the love again in the hearts of the believer. And the one can seek rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if your brother invites you, that you respond to his invitation. And like the ulama say that responding to the invitation is one of the signs of the cleanliness of the heart, right? For someone who has a clean heart, who has no other, like no problems, no animosity with anyone else, you know, and takes everyone as his brothers, then he would easily respond to the invitation, and he will find in himself that it is hard for him to turn down an invitation, and he will be thinking about how would the person who had invited him think about, how he will be, how he will be feeling if his invitation is not accepted, and he would accept for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, this is something that is virtuous. Now, of course, unless there is a reason for him to not to respond to the invitation, if there is something that is haram in the gathering, for example, there is mixing between men and women, there are like, music, there is whatever, a visitation that will make him, for example, not attend the prayer or something like that. And all these things are reasons for the one to maybe, not respond to the invitation. But in general, this is the right of a Muslim or non-Muslim. And if someone comes and approaches you with an invitation, then it is one of the good manners and one of the virtuous things and one of his rights that he would respond to the invitation. And then to the rest of the hadith, we went over most of what's mentioned in it in the past. The other thing is that what would the one say if he sees someone who is afflicted by a disease? عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من رأى مبتلا فقال الحمد لله الذي عافاني مما ابتلاك به وفضلني على كثير ممن خلق تفضيلا لم يصبه ذلك البلاء. أخرجه الطبراني في الأوسط. والحديث صحيح. Ibn Umar, may Allah please with him and his father, he said, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever sees a mubtala, mubtala is someone who is afflicted by a hardship and can be in the form of a disease state. And then he says, Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah, الَّذِي عَثَانِي مِمَّا ابْتَلَاكَ بِهِ, the one who had عافاني, meaning giving me the mu'afa, had prevented me from having the same disease state that you were afflicted by. وفضلني على كثير ممن خلق تفضيلا, and he made me better than many others of his creation, then he would not be afflicted by the same disease. And this authentic hadith, and shows how, again, this is something that reminds the one with the virtue of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his bounty, with the ni'mah of the health, right? So this is one of the things that the Muslim should remember, this dua, where if he sees someone who's afflicted by any disease state, by any musibah, that he will remember the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on him immediately, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that aspect had made him better than others, right? And he would say, Alhamdulillah, alladhi aathani mimma btalaka bih, wa faddalani ala kathirin mimman khalaqa tafdila. Again, Alhamdulillah, alladhi aathani mimma btalaka bih, wa faddalani ala kathirin mimman khalaqa tafdila. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if he says that, then this disease would not afflict him. Now, when it comes to the etiquettes of the actual visit, when the one comes to visit the sick, and this is the subject that we are talking about after this introduction, Ibn Abbas, may Allah please with him and his father, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam كان إذا عاد المريض جلس عند رأسه, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to, if he would visit the sick, that he would sit next to his head. And this hadith is an authentic hadith. Imam Bukhari had narrated this hadith in his book Al-Adab Al-Mufrad. And then there are things that the one should say to the one who is sick that he is visiting. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال. Ibn Abbas, may Allah please with him and his father, he narrated that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من عاد مريضا لم يحضر أجله فقال عنده سبع مرات. أسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يشفيك إلا عفاه الله من ذلك المرض. أخرجه أبو داود والترمذي والحديث صحيح. The authentic hadith narrated by Ibn Abbas, may Allah please with him and his father, he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whoever visits a sick, that his ajal did not come, meaning this was not the time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had already written that he will die. And when he visits him during that sickness, and he says to him 7 times, أسأل الله العظيم رب العرش العظيم أن يشفيك, he would say to him, I ask Allah, the greatest, the Lord of the great throne, that he would cure you. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إلا عفاه الله من ذلك المرض. And if he says that 7 times, and this was not the disease that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decided that this is what he's going to die with at this time, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him cure. So again, the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is As'alullah al-azim, Rabb al-arsh al-azim an yashfiyak. Easy thing to remember, and they're very virtuous, again, to remember it and apply it when you visit the sick. As'alullah al-azim, Rabb al-arsh al-azim an yashfiyak. I ask Allah, the great, the Lord of the great throne, that he would cure you. وعن عبد الله بن عمرو رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا جاء الرجل يعود مريضا فليقل اللهم اشف عبدك ينكأ لك عدوا أو يمشي لك إلى صلاة. أخرجه أحمد وأبو داود. The sound hadith narrated by Abdullah bin Amr, may Allah please with him and his father, that the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if a man comes to visit a sick, then let him say, Allahumma shfi abdaka yanka'u laka aduwan aw yamshi laka ila salah. O Allah, O our Lord, cure such and such of your slave, he will be opposing your enemy, or he will be walking for you in for salah. Meaning that this is what a Muslim does. His existence is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, And it's all virtuous. And that is the virtue of a Muslim. He lives as a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and as such, all what he does in his life is good. If he does everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he looks at his life on this earth as from the correct angle, where he is a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the priority in his life for his deen, right? And he does everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then what he does, he establishes the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, walking for the salah and defending his religion. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا أتى مريضا أو أتي به إليه قال عليه الصلاة والسلام أذهب الباس رب الناس اشفي وأنت الشافي لا شفاء إلا شفاءك شفاء لا يغادر سقما. Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to, if he would visit a sick or a sick person would be bought for him, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say, أذهب الباس, he would make the dua by saying, remove the hardship, رب الناس, O Lord of the people. يعني, O Lord of the people, remove the hardship, اشفي وأنت الشافي, cure, and you are the one who gives the cure. لا شفاء إلا شفاءك, there is no cure except by your cure. شفاء لا يغادر سقما, cure that does not leave behind any sickness. Again, أذهب الباس رب الناس اشفي وأنت الشافي لا شفاء إلا شفاءك شفاء لا يغادر سقما. Maybe it's time to write something new. Inshallah, we'll write these things on the board so that the one would try to remember them and apply them. Inshallah. And this hadith is agreed upon. Again, returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the principles of the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We take the means, but the cure is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, we take the medication, we go to the doctors, we go to the hospitals, we undergo surgeries and all these things, but the one who gives cure is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا شفاء إلا شفاءك. There is no cure except your cure. And this is what the heart of the Muslim has to be attached with when he is taking the means. We take the means, and this is part of our deen, to take the means, because these are the ways Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made on this earth. Right? But with the heart attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. And there's no contradiction between the two. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال إن حديث يعني وجزء من الحديث قال وكان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل على مريض يعوده قال لا بأس طهور إن شاء الله. أخرجه البخاري. إمام البخاري narrated the hadith of Ibn Abbas, may Allah please with him and his father. He said in a portion of the hadith, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to, if he would enter upon a sick person to visit him, he would say, لا بأس طهور إن شاء الله. He say, لا بأس طهور إن شاء الله. يعني, لا بأس, never mind, no hardship, طهور إن شاء الله, may be this be a طهور, meaning a way of expiating the sins. Right? إن شاء الله, by the will of Allah. So again, لا بأس طهور إن شاء الله, this is one of the things that the one would say it to the one who is sick. Even if you meet someone who is, not necessarily visiting him, but you go across him and you see that he is having a sickness, he's having bad cold or something like that, you say, لا بأس طهور إن شاء الله. Right? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this a reason for expiation of your sins. And the other ad'iyah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we have mentioned. We'll take two more hadith, then inshallah we'll continue next week. النفث على المريض. عائشة رضي الله عنها عن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان ينفث على نفسه في المرض الذي مات فيه بالمعوذات. فلما ثقل كنت أنفث عليه بهن وأمسح بيد نفسه لبركتها. متفق عليه. Aisha, may Allah please with him, with her, she narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to, in the sickness in which he died sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kana yanfutu ala nafsihi, he used to make the nafth on himself, We'll come to explain what that is. With the mu'awidat. The mu'awidat, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. So the Prophet ﷺ used to make nafth. She said, when he became very severely sick and he was unable to do that for himself, she said, كُنْتُ أَنْفُثُ عَلَيْهِ بِهِنْ. That I used to make the nafth with the mu'awidat on him. She said, وَأَمْسَحُ بِيَدِ نَفْسِهِ لِبَرَكَتِهَا. And because of the blessing of his hands, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while she is reading the mu'awidat, making the nafth, she would, instead of wiping with her hands, she would wipe with his own hands on him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said, because of the barakah of it, because of the blessing of it. The hadith, one of the narrators of the hadith in the chain of the narration is Az-Zuhri, that he narrated the hadith from Urwa, and Urwa narrated this hadith from Aisha. So one of the narrators of Az-Zuhri, in the, one of the narrations, he asked Az-Zuhri, he said, فَسَأَلْتُ الزُّهْرِي كَيْفَ يَنْفُثُ, how would he make this nafth? He said, قال كان ينفث على يديه ثم يمسح بهما وجهه. He said he used to make the nafth on his hands and then he would wipe his face with them. So the nafth is to blow something out between, like just blowing air and spitting out. So you actually not bringing spit out, but it's something that is like in between blowing and splitting out, like real, like, you know, saliva. So something like this, right? This is the nafth, right? And the way to do it is to read on the hands and make the nafth and then wipe the body parts. And this is the way, as Zuhri had explained it, this is the way to do the nafth. And this is one of the ways of, you know, reading the Quran, making the ruqya. Making the ruqya when it comes for someone who is, you know, afflicted by anything that he wants to make a ruqya for, or even when he wants to do the adhkar. For example, when the one goes to sleep, this is one of the adhkar that the one says when he goes to bed before he sleeps, that he would read قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, and he would make the nafth on his hand, then wipe off his body parts as much as he can, and he would do that 3 times. Right, so this is one of the ways of making the ruqya, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do it. Right, so again, if the one is afflicted by, for example, pain that you have in your chest, pain in your belly, all of a sudden happens, and if the immediate response should not be to be worried and be making phone call and all that, start with, mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa taala. Make a ruqya for your own self. Right, put your hand at the place where you are afflicted by the sudden pain or shortness of breath or whatever it is, and read al-Fatiha, read al-Mu'awwidhat, right? Make the naf on your hands and then wipe your body. Take these means because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the Qur'an a cure, right? It's cure from the mental illnesses and it's cure from the physical illnesses as well, right? But it takes that the one really is like, and he has a firm belief in that and he is applying the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his life. Right, and then if someone is sick and for example your wife, your kid, they are complaining from something, your child goes and hit his head with something, instead of just going and be worried about it, start by putting your hand on the place where he hit himself or where he's hurting, say Bismillah, read for him Al-Fatiha, make the nafth on him like Aisha did for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Again, these are one of the ways of taking the means of the cure by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and incorporating the relationship of Allah with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our life so that the hearts are always attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that the cure is only from him. So inshallah, for the sake of time, we'll stop here and we'll continue with the rest of the etiquettes of visiting the sick next week if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.